Hello, Tony here from Lightwave Digital. In this last part of the particle emitters, I want to go through the last four tabs of the emitter properties. So we've got rotate, interaction, file, edit effect. But I thought what I'd do, rather than just go through them and see them changing little bits on the actual screen, I thought that I'd go through them quite quickly and basically, but then show you some examples like this one. Of just particles interacting with objects and explain what I've done to get that effect, like so. So if we start with the actual rotation tab. So with the rotation tab, if it's on none, no rotation will be calculated for the particles. If it's on align to path, the particles will align and rotate to the path it's traveling along, which I've got an animation path here of the actual ball rolling along. And then you've got underneath this, you've got the random rotation and scale. When you click on this, it unlocks the actual dull button. And when you click it, it brings up this random rotation, which means you can experiment with how they rotate, the scale and the spin of the particles. So let me just go back to what I originally had it on. So that's the basics of that one, the rotation. For interacting, this is how they self-interact and how they interact with other objects, and then the force of that and the velocity of that. And then if you've not got this clicked here, detect into interaction, it won't work. So for this one here, I've actually got it on bounce because I want it to bounce and interact with, I want the particles to bounce and I want them to also interact with themselves and the actual ground. So when I press play, as you can see, the ball's rotating and then it's hitting. And with stuff like this, when you've got more interaction, it's always good to kind of just click and calculate, because there's actually a collision for the ground, but I've also got the actual a rigid body on the ball and a collision for the ground. And I'll explain that when I just go through these other quick tabs really quickly. So as you see, it's calculating through and showing you what's happening. So it's calculated. Let's just press play. Like so. And I'll go through the settings for this when I get to it, because I am zipping through this. Like I said, there is other self options. So you've got push. So when they hit each other, they'll push each other aside. There's drag and there's crowd. So when they're hitting together, if you've got them sort of landing on the floor and they're staying on the floor, they will start moving together into clumps and stuff. Like that, and then you've got the force out, how strong it's going to be. And again, you just need to play with this kind of stuff. For the file, this is where you can save the actual files out if you wish, and then load them back in. So obviously, you've got the save motion and load motion and so on. So save motion is just really a great time saver if you want to create your like presets of your particles and stuff. And then you've got obviously your copy and paste. So the copy and paste, these are like clipboard buttons that allows you to copy the settings from the controller and apply them to others. And then you've got the save and load. These buttons add custom save particle effects controllers to your scene. And then you've got the playback mode. You've got normal key and parent key. So like normal indicates that it will be played back normally starting from frame zero. And then if on the key, that's kind of like the motion will be started every time there's a keyframe that is encountered for your emitter. Again, I am kind of zipping through that, but you can save this out and load it back in. For the last tab, the edit effects tab. So this is this contains options for real-time editing in particles. I've never really used it that much, if I'm really honest. You can, if you want, like, click the edit tool. Let's say I want to click on certain particles and move them around at certain points. You can do this. I think a while back I did one where I did, and I'll try and find an example where I had like a bouncing ball jumping out of a box using emitters and replace the emitter, wherever there was a particle, I added a little bouncy ball. And so every now and then a ball would bounce out this box and then bounce on the floor. But I remember one or two went a bit haywire the wrong way. So I used this to move individual particles, which the ball was attached to a position that I wanted. So with this, yeah, there's different options as well. So you've got an undo, but it'll only undo once. And then you've got all after, before, and current. So on current, that means whatever frame you're on, you can use. You've got after the current frame, before the current frame, or you've just got all. And so on. I mean, the best thing to do with this is to have a play around with it. I don't want to go into too much depth, so you can decide on where and it's fixed and where it's end for individuals or all the polygons as well. And what I'll do is I'll try and find the little box to outcome which shows you how we have used this as an option as well. Because if you get into it, it can be. Quite fun. And I believe a while back, William Vaughan did a tutorial using this and how to use this option with a path. So I'll find that and I'll put it in the description as well, because it's quite a cool tutorial. But what I want to do now is I want to go through some examples and show you how I've used different options here to come up with some examples, starting with this first one. So let's take a look at the first example. So what I've got is I've got this ball and a ground plane. So what I've done is I went up to the effects tool, and then what I did is I made the ground kinematic. I didn't have to, I could just make it static, but I was thinking that maybe I might animate the ground so the ball bounces more. I haven't done that, but I just made that, and then the ball rigid. And then basic settings, I've hardly changed anything to do with the actual... the only thing I changed is I made it a sphere. And so what it does is that's doing the bounce, like so. And I made the ball rotate beforehand. So then what I did is I added the emitter to the ball by selecting the ball, going to the effects tab under properties, and then adding the settings. So I stuck with like a burr frame of 100 per frame, using the surface as a nozzle with no change. I've just left the size and added a few zeros in the particle limit. The actual lifetime of the particles are 40 frames. I've animated the explosion. So what I did is I thought when it hits the ground, I want it to be a bit explosive. So what I did is just added a basic spike at times from like 0 to 1. And this one's just below, it's about 0.7. So when it hits the ground, you get a bit of a more of a kind of that effect. Obviously, you've got to calculate it. I haven't calculated this yet, so it needs to be a bit more accurate as it is. I've put normal gravity, and then I've got not mess with the rotation. I've had self interaction to bounce with the force and velocity at 50. And so with the ground, I've then gone, so the actual particles interact with the ground as well. I've made it a collision that's bounced at 250, because you have to do this because the actual effects ground will acknowledge the particles. And then that's what you kind of get, where the ball is kind of bouncing. And as it hits, because I've got the spike on, and it rolls off slice. So, as you can see. But like I said, I'll recalculate that. Just like that. So that's the first example, and I've zipped through it all. Okay. So let's go on to the second example. So let's have a look at example two. So example two is just a sphere that's fractured. And to the actual object, the ball, I've also added a particle emitter, which means it's going to... each part of the actual sphere is going to have an emitter to it. If we go to the dynamics under the effects tool, the ground's the same. All I've done is made this ball a mesh, and I've made it tight so the parts the dynamics. And so, and then obviously with the actual emitter attached, I've animated the birth rate. So as it falls, it's 100, but then as it's just about to hit the ground, it jumps up 50. And I just want a few more particles by frame, generated from the surface, no size change, couple more zeros, lifetime is 60 frames, and it's got Earth's gravity, and it's got bounce self-interaction. So let's press play. Nothing special, but these particles then could be textured in hypervoxels as dust. So that's example two. That's straightforward. Okay, with example three, I've basically got a ball that's following a path. So I created a curve in Modeler, brought it through with the curve. If you've never used curves before, you have to tell Lightwave to show it, otherwise it will come through invisible. So you need to go to Appearance, drop down, show curve, and then you need to click on these. You can decide what colour it is. And when you and then I've attached the ball to the curve. Now it will always attach it to the place where you start creating the curve in Modeler. So this is a fun. It's telling, showing you the arrows the way it's going anyway. And I've attached the actual ball by going to motion options and adding curve constraints. I've added, you choose what you actually want to attach it to the curve and the align it to, and you can adjust the actual start and end. You can have an influence over the curve as well. So basically, once I've done that, I also added a basic emitter to it here. And if I show the emitter, so it's 50 frames, 50 per frames, object surface. I've left it as a default size density for more zeros. Lifetime, I've left it to zero, so they're going to live and die forever. Sorry, they're just going to live forever. And I've not got anything else. Apart from on the peer motion, I put zero so it stays exactly on the actual path for me. So if I press play, and then after it, if I just pause, you'll notice, then I've added a collision object, a wind object. So with the wind object, what I've done is added the rotational by 5,000 and the spiral, I've timed it to spin 10 times, so 10 times 360. So it's actually spinning, and it's also going to be following and affecting the actual particles, like so. Very basic, but still cool. And you can play with the speed and the strength of the actual wing if you want, and try turbulence on it and different stuff. Now, if I didn't have a wind, so let's go to the wind, let's turn it off, let's go to my scene editor, let's just get rid of the wind up in here as well. Okay, and what I'll also do is let's add gravity, Earth's gravity, so it will fall. But what I've done is on the ground, we've also got a little bounce, but it's very low. But they should literally just stick on this. So let's just calculate this anyway, see what happens. Okay, so this time we've got gravity. There's no wind, but the ground's got it's got the standard 100% bounce, so it's not really bouncing a lot. I can turn it right up to do that. So as you can see, it's making the trail stick to the ground, like so. It's quite cool as well. But again, like I've said before, you just need to play around with the settings on here. So if I just stop this, made this something silly like 1,000, and recalculate. Okay, let's press play. And as you can see, because of how strong I've put it, it's bouncing up quite high, like so. And that's the basics of example three. So for example four, I couldn't find the actual ball test that I told you about, so I just made it. It's quite quick to do anyway. So basically what it is this. So all I've got is a ground plane with a collision, a box, and inside the box, I've got the particle emitter. And so with the particle emitter, I just bring up the settings for that. I've got one particle a second coming out. I've made it box to match with the box it's in. No change, the size, particle limit, and then everything else apart from, well, I've given the lifetime to zero so they don't actually die in it. They're just gone forever. And then I've just played with the actual velocity, so they're actually getting us, like, pushed out this way towards the camera. And then there's a little bit of vibration and explosion, and then gravity on it of -9.8. And then what I've done is I've then gone to the instance sim. Let me just stop this a second. So, under instancing, I've added the generator. Use the ball that I've had, that I want to place on each particle, which is actually in the background. It doesn't even have to be on. Use particles here, and then everything else I've just left the same. I don't really want it to be changed, to be honest. So it just replaces the actual particles with the ball. It could replace them with anything. What I did do is on the ground, had a collision. I've just brought the radius up a little bit. Reason being, the balls were going quite under the actual ground level. So I've just tweaked it a little bit. They're still going under the ground, but I've left it because it kind of looks like they're like squishing as they're hitting. And so it's hypi-accident, really. So when they're hitting, they are actually going under the ground, but it gives the illusion of them like squishing as they're hitting the ground. So I'm just going to leave it at that for the time being. But you can rise the level it's hitting the collision course up. And the bounce level's 200. And the type I've put to object subdivide, it seems to, even though it's not an object subdivide, it seems to be working better than plain. And then I click to calculate. So it's as easy as that one. I've zipped through it, but it's not hard. Once you've got your emitter, go into instance in and just choose the object you want to replace. I mean, it doesn't have to be this, it could be anything. One last thing I will show you, as I mentioned before. So I've got the balls jumping out here, as you can see. And this one's in the actual, sticking in the actual box. Let's just go to the ball, double click it. Let's have a look under this edit effect. Let's go along to which one it is. So I think it's actually saying it's number one. It's just why we're on this, look, edit the node. Let's move it up and around. So this time that one isn't hitting. There's a different one hitting, I believe, that one. Which one is that one? There we go. It's on, it's actually the first one. Let's just move that as well. See if there's any others. That one's better. Jumping up on this one there. So number five just needs moving like so. So you can actually edit individual using the edit effects if you've got stuff like this. And go in and choose which edit node you want to, and then move it. So it's pretty cool as well to do, be able to do that. That's just the last thing I just wanted to show you. Oh, I hope you enjoyed the tutorial. What I'd like to do is I'd like to finish by showing you a particle showreel by David Ridlon, a visual effects artist. So this is some of the stuff he's done using Lightwave particles for the last 20 years, and it's pretty amazing.
Since Oh,